Thank you for accessing the archived version of the latest Scaling What Works webinar from GEO. Exploring the briefing paper, What Do We Mean by Scale? This webinar, originally presented on March 10th, 2011, featured Jim Keddie of the California Endowment, Alex Rosides of the Growth Philanthropy Network, and Dara Major, author of the briefing paper. Nancy Murphy, Executive Vice President for GEO, moderated the discussion. This archived recording begins with a snapshot of webinar attendees and then dives right into content. Enjoy!
This is an overview of the folks we have participating today. Interesting to note, we have quite a number of representatives who are with foundations or grantmakers with a local and regional scope. So hopefully we'll do a good job today of giving you all a sense of how you can incorporate this into an organization that's focused at the local level. And again, some great feedback on how what particularly folks are interested in, what you want to get out of today. I love this comment, scale's been the buzzword for a while, so I just wanted to find out what this was all about. We've certainly heard that from lots of folks, and we'll hopefully give you a good introduction today. How are others considering scale? Where's the most momentum and why? All good topics. I think most people on the phone are familiar with GEO, but we are a network of 360 grantmakers that believe they're successful only to the extent that their grantees achieve meaningful results. And we're hosting today's webinar because in that spirit, we launched an initiative supported by 22 funders about a year ago called Scaling What Works. And Scaling What Works aims to convene conversations between public sector funders of the Social Innovation Fund and philanthropy to grow the number of grantmakers who are better positioned to scale impact and to support collective learning and ensuring lessons learned from the Social Innovation Fund and other innovation experiments are shared broadly with others in philanthropy. As I mentioned at the beginning, today's conversation is on the first briefing paper in a series on growing social impact. And we really do see these papers as reframing the conversation. And you'll see we've organized them into three clusters. And many of the questions that people sent in, they were hoping to get addressed today, or topics of interest, are ones where we are developing some additional papers focused exclusively in those areas. And we hope you'll join us for future conversations around these topics. We do want to continue to hear from you, so please feel free to submit a question at any time using the instant messaging or chat function, and we will consolidate the questions into different themes and hopefully have time at the end to have lots of discussion. Also, if you're interested in continuing the conversation on any particular aspect of this, please let us know on your evaluation. Tell us if you want more. Also, we are recording this this webinar, so it will be available later on the GEO website if you want to listen to it again or direct any of your colleagues who were not able to join us today to that recording. So before we launch right into our panel, wanted to take a moment and just ask you to participate in the webinar by telling us what you think of when you hear the word scale. And you can again submit your comments through the IM function, and we'll see what the results are as we move forward. I already gave you a little bit of background on Dara, and I think we'll just get right into the content. So Dara, tell us how you conducted your research. What were some of the highlights of that?
Thank you, Nancy. Well, first, I'd love to just say it's great to be with all of you today and to connect on what are some really promising ideas and practices. After some initial and close consultation with the GEO team, I conducted really extensive secondary research, reviewing existing research in the philanthropic field and conducting something of a landscape analysis. What is the current state of research on these topics? and what does that look like in relation to practice? I also took a deep dive into practice by talking with over 30 practitioners, ranging across foundation type, as well as nonprofits, organizations that have either scaled or are currently in a growth process, as well as intermediaries that have supported these efforts.
And Sarah, tell us a little bit about, so you did some research and you talked to some practitioners, and based on your research, what did you think you were going to hear, and was that what you heard?
Sure. Well, I'm not sure that I had a clear set of expectations going into this inquiry. And in fact, it was my sense that the existing body of research on going to scale, sort of the who, what, and how of scaling for social impact, maybe was a little behind current practices. There are certainly some leading standouts in the research community. Harvard, Bridgespan, I've cited a number of these and others in the paper that are really documenting what are essentially emerging practices. But what I found most exciting was the view from grantmakers themselves. Many have long struggled to achieve impact with limited resources, and I found that there is a lot of excitement and energy around this emerging reconceptualization of scale, this desire to harness complementary resources to achieve greater reach and impact than would be possible alone. And this is certainly true among funders working at the local and regional levels as well. So I found a lot of interest in pushing on current practice together. What I think is different about this current thinking about scale is that it does point and lead to some very concrete practices that funders of all kinds can adopt to more intentionally grow impact.
And so tell us a little bit more about what you now think of when you hear the word scale. How are we really defining this, and what are some of those practices?
Yes. Well, of course, philanthropists have long sought to scale social change, right? And we generally tend to think of this approach as one taken by, say, a single or two very large foundations. You know, think of the Rockefeller and Ford foundations and the Green Revolution, for instance, in relatively new or emerging fields. But the chief methods were really developing new organizations, growing programs, creating new science, essentially charting new pathways in wide open terrain. I think what's remarkably different about today's approaches to scale is the context within which we're all working. There is a real ecosystem of other funders, high-quality nonprofit organizations, private sector resources and approaches, as well as an increased capacity to kind of get our arms around that content in all new ways, to really understand and strengthen how we move within it. And what I heard in my interviews is that this is really enabling practitioners to shift focus from having to create new resources to making better use of the wealth of resources and the systems, what's already present in this rich ecosystem. And in my interviews, I heard, too, that this is singularly important in this economic downturn. So that said, shifting focus from the traditional sort of what we think of as bricks and mortar growth to impact, to knitting together complementary programs, ideas, approaches, capital, is not easy. And as I heard through the grant makers that I spoke with in this process, Nancy, grant makers really are very interested in pushing on practice, and for this reason are very eager to exchange ideas and to build on what we're learning as we go. Sorry, I was going to say, if we look at the next slide, we'll see that part of this shift in practice starts with something of a shift in mindset, moving from traditional approaches that are perhaps organizational or program-centered to putting impact at the center. And, you know, I'd be very interested in hearing about what folks on this webinar think as well, but you know, I heard a lot that in philanthropy, many of our systems, and for that matter, fundamental practices such as due diligence, are sometimes systems that have been designed to support, say, discrete actions by discrete actors. One grant maker makes one grant to one nonprofit organization. And what I heard many of the practitioners I spoke with say was, we're seeing that these systems are not always aligned with not only the challenges that we and the communities we support are facing, but also the opportunities to spread ideas, to collaborate in new ways, to affect policy change, for instance. Even grant makers who do not necessarily see themselves as directly supporting efforts to scale nonetheless increasingly want to understand where they sit in this ecosystem of change that they are supporting and to get more intentional about linking up with others along the way for greater impact.
So what we see in front of us here are different things that are being scaled. We're thinking about it either as a program, an idea, an innovation, a policy, a skill, so different definitions of that term scale. And just to give you a sense of what the audience thinks, when folks on the webinar hear the term scale, they think of the ability to do more in a bigger way, population level outcomes, economies of scale, widespread adoption or uptake, replicating a successful program, and greater reach. So I think, you know, folks on the phone seem to be pretty much aligned with this. Some people thinking it's all bigger and better at the same time, and some replication as well as other ideas. And so now we're going to ask people to think of a second question, which is how have you used any of these particular mechanisms to scale within your own philanthropy and programs? So have you used replication? Have you used marketing to scale skills or communications and marketing to scale an idea? What kind of advocacy have you done? And we're going to ask you to, again, provide us some thoughts on that. So as we move on to our next speaker, thank you, Dara. We have some key takeaways we just want to highlight for people. That scaling impact is more than just program replication. That's one aspect, but it's not all that it is. And funders have tools beyond just the grant check that you can use to support scaling impact. We already talked about some of your thoughts on that scale definition question. So now I'd like to move on to Jim. And Jim, when you first heard the topic of our briefing paper, what did you think we meant by scale? And then as you think about your answer there, also tell us a little bit about the Healthy Communities Initiative, and does this fit the non-traditional notion of scale that Dara has described?
Yes, thanks, Nancy. When I first heard about the webinar and thought of scale, like I think most folks, I thought of going bigger and better. But then I also thought, right after that, is we are in a particularly challenging moment to think about scale with the economic downturn, and particularly the cutbacks to government, because I think government's been, you know, a very big lever in terms of going to scale, and in some ways we're challenged with scaling down. But in the midst of that environment, the endowment has launched a 10-year initiative focused on children's health. Children healthy, safe, and ready to learn is kind of the impact we're seeking to make in California. It's a 10-year initiative, and we're essentially working through three gears, and I'll talk a little bit about each of these areas. We have a part of the initiative is place-based work, part of it's policy and advocacy at the state and federal level, and part of it is through the investment in public and private partnerships. So in terms of the place-based work, we're doing place-based work in 14 communities, and as you can see on the map, it's spread throughout the state. We are seeking to do policy and systems change at the local level and are treating the places as kind of laboratories for policy and systems change work. We are supporting community organizing among young people and adults in each place, and part of that is what we think of as sort of our outside-in strategy, where we're funding groups that will help, you know, apply pressure and create momentum and visibility around the change that we're seeking to make happen. But at the same time, we're also funding and doing what we call inside out, which is that we're making grants to systems themselves and leaders inside those systems to who are, you know, drivers of change and who are aligned with us. So, for example, we might fund in a place a group of parents who are working to improve the school lunch program and school health. And at the same time, we could be funding a superintendent and his and helping him with his staffing challenges around how you go about you know, making the changes to needed to improve a school lunch program. And then as part of the initiative, we're also just being very explicit and having an ongoing conversation about the role of power and the role of race and structural racism and how resources are distributed and kind of the impact of, you know, that legacy on low-income communities in California. And as I mentioned, another strand of our work is funding policy advocacy at the state level and at the federal level. So we're funding organizations that are doing policy work and advocacy at our state capital and in Washington, D.C. And the, you know, the kind of the top priorities there are around the implementation of the new federal health law, obesity prevention, and supports for young people as a way to prevent violence downstream. And we see these policy arenas as all interacting with one another. So, you know, I think the traditional way people think about policy work is innovation is you do work at a local level and then it bubbles up and you try to bring it to scale. But we also are seeing, you know, the dynamic where the, particularly the federal government with the federal health law is driving policy and change at the local level. And we're trying to get ahead of that and working very hard to make the federal health law real in California and to, you know, move into implementation as effectively and as quickly as possible. And then finally, I'll just say a word here about mission-related investments in PRIs, which is a new area for the endowment. It's not a part of the work that we have as much experience with, but we are trying to figure out how we activate the private sector as a partner. You know, we're trying to understand the whole ecosystem of social change, government, nonprofits, and the private sector. And our first kind of foray into this area is by creating a pool of capital, which we call the Healthy Food Financing Initiative, which will help bring grocery stores to food deserts, to expand access to healthy food in communities where there's little of that. And that's going to take various forms. It could be a corner market that needs a loan in order to buy the refrigeration equipment to carry more produce. So that's kind of our first step into this, and it's an area that we're excited to learn more about.
And so, Jim, along those lines, you talked about mission-related investments, or PRIs, which is a particular grant-making approach that is contributing to your strategy. Mm-hmm. Are there other grant-making practices that you're incorporating into this idea that you think are going to drive greater impact and scale?
Yes, thank you. Let me show you the next slide here. So part of what we're doing is we do have a sort of a my very proactive effort with media underway, where we're both using social networking to connect our partners at the local level, at the state level, and sort of a online dialogue. This slide shows you sort of a social networking site for our East Oakland place. We're also funding media and doing paid media to get the word out about what we're doing. We recently funded a statewide television commercial and on Spanish-speaking media about the federal health law. And then in addition to media, we also are, as I mentioned earlier, doing grants both to systems and to grassroots advocacy. We're doing grants at the local and at the state level, all aligned with the same goal. And then another strategy that you know, we find really critical to creating the synergy and the momentum, kind of what you need to really build momentum, is bringing people together and functioning as a convener of folks who are working at a grassroots level, as well as, you know, for example, our superintendent of public instruction in California, kind of putting people in the same room and building relationships and creating a dialogue across multiple sectors of the state. Okay. How are we doing, Nancy?
Sorry, I had myself on mute there, and I'm talking.
That's okay. It's all right.
So I'm actually going to diverge from this question a little bit because we got lots of questions about this idea of the relationship between scale and evaluation. And should we scale only proven programs? And if so, what does proven really mean?
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about how that thinking informed or didn't. Are you testing things now, or are these things that are already proven? And what do you see as the relationship between scale and evaluation?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I would say that we are really open to testing and trying out new strategies, and we're not strictly trying to replicate what we know there's already a research base for. And I think the challenge that we're really confronting in the evaluation part of what we're doing is, how do we learn in real time? So over this 10-year period, how do we use assessment and evaluation and feedback loops in order to adjust what we're doing, take advantage of new opportunities, and try to be as agile as possible? You know, what we want to try to avoid is having the initiative kind of function on autopilot and miss opportunities that appear in the environment. We're clearly at a time in which things are changing every few years, and so that's this kind of learning in real time is our primary focus, and it's still very much something that we're talking to others about and trying to understand more about, and are really interested in how others are thinking about it. Yeah.
Great. So, you know, one of the notes I made to myself as I was looking at a lot of the questions coming in is that I think there are more questions than answers at this point. So we're hoping that all the participants on this dialogue will, you know, reach out to you or each other on here and think about how we can continue the conversation, because I think we don't have all the answers. It's not that they're there and the participants on this webinar just hope to come here today and get them. I think it's all, you know, still evolving. So talk to us a little bit more about this diagram here that's on the screen and how these strategies sort of interplay with the whole idea of scale in mind.
Right, yeah. So what we see here is kind of what we see is kind of components that interact in a social change strategy. So we want to make changes to policy and systems, but we know that until policy and systems also result in change in practice, we really don't achieve the change we're seeking. So we're trying to understand both policy and change in practice as key, and then how those kind of interact with one another to create larger sort of what we consider to be social norms change. And to kind of help explain that, I thought I might just use the example of the fight against smoking and tobacco use in California that began, you know, 25 or 30 years ago, when people at a local level started to work with local city councils to do indoor smoking bans. At that time, you know, it was impossible to pass legislation limiting tobacco use at the state capitol because of the influence of the tobacco industry in the legislature, and so the fight actually began at the local level, and over time there was momentum created, which then led to change at the state level. We passed a state initiative here, a tobacco tax, and then began to fund prevention and cessation, tobacco cessation at a much larger scale. And then eventually I think it all rolled up to be what has been a significant change in social norms in California as well as other places, where now we have, smoking is just not part of what everybody does. And so when we think about our long-term vision and scaling up, this idea of social norms change captures a lot of that for us, where it's the whole ecosystem kind of transforming and changing practice and how just kind of how we live. And our goal, of course, as a health foundation, is to part of that social norms is just to think have health be understood not just as what happens in a doctor's office, but health as part of how one lives one's life, and prevention and sort of the creation of healthy environments, which then promote health.
That's great. And I think, Jim, this particular description really hits home a point you, I think, made to me yesterday, that you're moving from grant maker to change maker.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like that phrase and that way of thinking. And so thank you for giving us a really concrete example, as much of a snapshot as it was, as to how one foundation is approaching this. And so, again, some highlights from Jim's comments. To grow impact is not to go it alone. So I think we're going to hear a lot more when we hear from Alex about how funders need to work together to make these kinds of changes. And that rather than asking nonprofits to always do more with less, we can think about how funders can invest more in approaches we know produce results, even if that means sort of learning along the way about what those things are and testing some things out and then adjusting as we start to get some information back. So here are some answers to the questions from participants about what approaches you have used to scale impact. So policy advocacy to incent adoption. So similar to the story that Jim was just sharing with us. Investing in organizational capacity. We at GEO like to hear those kinds of approaches. Marketing and communications campaigns. Again, so Jim was talking about his outreach to the media. And building bridges with other funders, which is a perfect segue to what Alex is going to talk to us about. And continue to send in your questions. We're going to have time at the end where we can hear from everybody, so and hopefully get the panels to address your questions as well. So please feel free to keep sending those in. So as I mentioned earlier, Alex Rosides with Growth Philanthropy Network. And Alex, tell us a little bit about your particular approach, which centers around this of building an effective market for replication of programs, and what are the elements of an effective marketplace that you're working on to help bring new voices, different kinds of investors into this scale conversation?
Thanks, Nancy. And as Nancy said, our work centers around establishing a philanthropic capital marketplace, one that can consistently fund high-quality scaling efforts, and a market that involves over time, thousands of funders, national funders and local funders and in different issue areas. And over time, one that can generate billions of dollars annually in support of scaling efforts or high quality scaling efforts in order to really move the needle. And I'm going to share just a little bit about how we've gotten to this point, which is its own scaling story, if you will, and then really focus on how grant makers can participate in a marketplace to learn about and fund scaling initiatives and to do it together. And first, though, I thought it'd be helpful to address a question that we often get, which is, why do we need a marketplace? And the answer to that is that scaling is really too expensive for any one funder to do on their own. As was mentioned, you know, the government has been a primary scaler, and they're going to be pulling back. And it's just too expensive for any one foundation to do it on its own. And so there's a real need for a system to bring collaborative capital together consistently to fund scaling from philanthropy. And so the goal of a marketplace is really to efficiently connect high-impact nonprofits with funders and make sure that you're connecting it to funders, the organizations that meet funders' interests. And it can be in program replication, it can be in product rollout, it can be in policy, a variety of different ways to do it and in different geographies. But the key is to enable grant makers to find and fund these effective interventions easily. And so how did we get here, which answers the question of some of these fundamental elements of a marketplace. For the first 5 years of our existence, GPN and others have focused on these foundational elements of a marketplace, which to a large extent are now established. And they include things like investment standards. We know a lot about how to evaluate scaling investments. It includes financing processes. We have several really good, successful models for collaborative funding. The Edna McConnell Clark Foundation has created aggregation pilots. New Profit, which is an intermediary, has done this work via a fund model. So we have some precedent. There's now significant deal flow. There's a decent number of nonprofits out there with evidence, at different stages of evidence. It could be promising or proven, and readiness to scale up. So there's actually product out there. And we also now, with the launch of the Social Innovation Fund and lots of pioneers that preceded the Social Innovation Fund, we have I would say at least 20 intermediaries that facilitate and have experience facilitating capacity building and connecting capital to growing nonprofits. And all those were really important fundamental elements of a marketplace. And they are, to certain degrees, now in place. So the question is, how do we actually scale a marketplace so that thousands of funders can participate, all the folks on the phone and just across the country locally and nationally? And for that, you really need a mechanism for large-scale distribution, connecting nonprofits that are scaling their initiatives to thousands of funders, or else we'll never have enough capital to really move the needle on these issues. And secondly, a place, a common forum, if you will, for the field to come together and work together on building that marketplace and learning together. And I'll talk more about that in a second. And so
Alex,
yeah, go ahead.
Before you walk through this slide, I wonder if in talking about these different groups, you also might help some of our audience members understand how these different groups assess readiness for growth, and do wealth managers look at it the same way that funding collaboratives do or that local networks of funders do?
Yes, that's a great question. The folks that are on the cutting edge, if you will, and have had experience over the last number of years, 3, 4, 5, 6 years, in evaluating scaling efforts have been certain evaluation firms like MDRC and Public Private Ventures, and their work has seeped into the work of a number of established foundations and intermediaries that have been doing this work for, let's say, a half a decade, and really trying to understand both, one, the evidence level that merits an organization moving to the next level of scale. So that evidence can be at an early stage of outcomes evidence, and it can indicate that this organization is promising and maybe merits an investment of a certain amount of money to get it to the next level of growth and scaled impact, and also for it to develop additional evidence. And then you move up a continuum of evidence till you get to these randomized control trials, and at which point, if you have some real proof through these experimental studies, an organization or a scaled program may merit a much larger amount of money, even $30, $40 million, so that it can reach tens of thousands of individuals once it's proven. There's a whole second set of evaluation criteria around readiness to scale. And the readiness to scale addresses things like organizational capacity, is there demand in the marketplace, are there standard processes that can be rolled out, is there a financial model that's sustainable? And the association that I'll tell you about in a minute, the Social Impact Exchange, has a working group that's developed in collaboration with many of these folks a framework that should be available in about a month or so, that kind of brings together a lot of that best practice thinking. So that is something that will be shared. But so there is a lot that has been done, and one of the keys is to be able to share it now with the rest of the field.
Great, thanks.
And you know, just to particularly to your question, Nancy, about these different kinds of funder groups, it really has been foundations and intermediaries that have sort of led the charge on understanding what kinds of due diligence and evaluation is important to do on organizations and initiatives that are scaling. The wealth management firms, private banks, philanthropic advisory firms, less so. And so the challenge becomes, how do we efficiently share and spread scaling initiatives with good information about them to funders in a way that they can collaborate to fund them, and in different cities, at different stages of growth, and in different issue areas. And the individual funders, the philanthropists, and the families have aggregated a lot of their philanthropic wealth in wealth management firms, private banks, and philanthropic advisory firms. So one key challenge is, how do we bring them into this work? Established foundations have aggregated into affinity groups and funder collaboratives and local networks, And again, the challenge is how to involve them in a systematic way and share these opportunities. And we, you know, spending some time on this with others, realize that this is, it's too much to create a system for this, you know, alone. And so it's clear we needed an association so that we could work on this together. And so what we've done is we have launched, to get to the next slide here. Hold on a second.
Yep, I think we see the social impact exchange.
Okay, it's not showing up on my computer. Oh, what? There we go. So are we on the slide that says Forum for Learning in Action?
There we are. We are now.
Wonderful. So we launched the Social Impact Exchange in 2009, which, and we did this in conjunction with Duke University. This is a national membership association completely dedicated and focused on scaling social solutions and building collaboratively a marketplace that can consistently fund these scaling efforts and that can learn together. There are now 2,700 members. Membership is free. It's a cross-sector association. So it has many funders in it, but it also has nonprofit CEOs and intermediaries and government officials. The funding came from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and Rockefeller and Gates and others. And there are about 180 funders on working groups. And the working groups are really the vehicle for building some of this marketplace infrastructure. And I'll just share with you some of the main strategies of the exchange. So we've established working groups in education, health, poverty, and youth, and the working groups will identify well-vetted, evidence-based scaling initiatives using some of these due diligence and evaluation frameworks we just mentioned, and they will share those identified high-impact, high-quality initiatives with funders in their field on a quarterly basis so that if you're a grant maker, you can join one of the working groups, or you can sign up to be in the affinity network that gets a chance to review these scaling opportunities and recommendations of the working group. It'll all be also online. So in essence, we're creating many marketplaces in these different fields so that large networks can access these high-quality opportunities. And we're going to do a similar thing on a local basis where local working groups associated with local networks working with regional associations and community foundations will be able to identify opportunities locally and scale them up. And all this work is done in collaboration with affinity groups like Grantmakers in Education and Grantmakers in Health so that we're building on what already exists. Secondly, to address the challenge of those distribution channels to private banks and donor advised funds and wealth management firms, we've established several pilots to bring these high impact opportunities to those institutions. And there are thousands of trusts in those institutions, philanthropic trusts. So being able to unlock those dollars will be important. Again, different audience than established foundations. We also have a national conference. In fact, it'll be on June 15th and 16th in New York City. And registration will be next week, or open next week. And it's an exciting venue where we have a business plan competition, an investment fair, or what we call a nonprofit showcase. And it gives it an opportunity for funders who want to engage in this marketplace either by helping to build it or participating as a reviewer of nonprofits can participate. And then finally, there are some exciting new products that are being explored to unlock capital. There's a social impact bond. Some of you may have heard of this. And there are folks that are exploring creating local scaling funds, if you will, to do this work. So I guess the closing point is everybody who would like to participate, there is a way to do so, whether it's locally or in different issues. You can get more information on the Social Impact Exchange website. But there's a real opportunity to get involved and to begin to learn how to actually engage in this work.
So there you go. Alex just reinforced those key takeaway points where every size and type of grantmaker can play important and meaningful roles in scaling impact. And as I've said a couple of times so far in this webinar, the conversation is emerging. We don't have all the answers, but there are resources and networks and places where people who want to continue the conversation can go to find others interested in the same things. Thank you so much, Alex. That was a great overview. I want to come back to Dara now. Alex just described some attempts through Growth Philanthropy Network and the Exchange to introduce some new funding vehicles and bring new funders to the table. And these are some of the same challenges that they're facing are things you uncovered in your research. And I think we're also hearing from lots of folks that this field is feeling a little stuck around this scale conversation, that there's so much, in some cases, jargon, or people aren't all, they don't all mean the same thing when they use the terms, and so we're not all on the same page when we're having the conversation. Can you talk to us a little bit more about this idea of being stuck, and what are some of the things you uncovered that can help us get unstuck?
Absolutely. Yeah, I heard from a number of grant makers that there's not only external pressure on grant makers right now to achieve better and more results, but also that many grant makers themselves are looking at the state of the fields and communities in which they work, many of which are just really hurting right now, and saying, you know what, we want to dramatically increase our investment in bringing effective approaches to scale. And the picture Alex just painted, hundreds of funders coming together to explore this, I think is yet another really exciting indication of this. There is a body of evidence that's growing all the time about what works, and we have better technology and stronger networks for knowledge and collaboration taking shape all the time. There's both, I think, a growing imperative, but also a renewed sense of possibility. And yet, I was struck in the interviews by the number of grant makers who said, we're feeling a little stuck in these old frames. And absolutely, I think some of the language and jargon gets in the way of moving on from that place. But some of these old frames include, for instance, as research by GEO and the Center for Effective Philanthropy has documented, that much of the grant support provided in philanthropy is of short duration and typically in small grants. And there are a few funders, frankly, who have the level of resources as individual actors to really have a significant role in scaling by themselves. And much of the activity, I think, that precedes these small individual grants is awfully duplicative and not to mention time-consuming for the grantor and grantee alike. As Ed Skloot used to say at the Cerdna Foundation, it's a bit like the IHOP theory of change. If we stack up all of this individual good work, we'll get to the impact that we all want eventually. But I heard loudly and clearly in the interviews that there's a growing recognition that this just is not cutting it. And it's my sense that there's a lot of really generative experimentation happening to figure out alternatives to some of these traditional patterns. And that grant makers are very interested in looking at the practices that support grantees that are really critical in the context of scale and lead to smarter grant making, stronger nonprofits, better results. And this includes getting clear about your purpose and approach. And whether you seek to directly support scaling or not, to take a look at your current practices and how they might better support grantee results. And this may include providing general operating support and, where possible, perhaps making multi-year commitments, as well as helping grantees to build their evidence base, because that is really key to scale, right? But for those that have evidence of what works, the challenge then becomes to assemble the level of capital, but also other resources needed for growth. This remains a slow, time-consuming endeavor for many nonprofits, and raising growth capital is particularly difficult. As Alex pointed out, one way many grantmakers are seeking to innovate is by reshaping their own role in the nonprofit capital market, just as each nonprofit organization has its own capital structure, there's a wide array of organizations, intermediaries, and types of support, including grants, loans, the PRIs that Jim talked about that really constitute the nonprofit capital market. Additionally, grantmakers can together with other grantmakers as well as grantees design and implement some new collaborative practices. This includes conducting due diligence together, trying on some new common reporting and evaluation practices, as well as aggregating capital and other organizational assistance. But I think ultimately it comes down to really adopting an ecosystem mindset. Many can start by simply having direct conversations with grantees about how you see your role with each grant, and perhaps consider taking a portfolio approach to your collection of grants, and considering devoting a portion of it to build or support intentional scaling. And along the way, build your own knowledge and skills in this area, as Nancy rightly has noted throughout this discussion. This mindset, this approach, these practices are very much emergent right now, and there is no one-size-fits-all approach to providing growth capital. But clarifying your approach and articulating what it is you seek to learn along the way is really key. Finally, I would just say, as one interviewee said to me, you know what, the very best way for grantmakers to build their own knowledge base on scale and growing impact is to do a deal with someone that you'd really like to learn with. Hook up with colleagues who share this mindset, and I think particularly for local and regional funders, this is not a new way of working, but rather a shift from this organizational, programmatic frame to one that's more expansive and putting impact at the center.
That's great, Dara. Thank you. And we've got some great questions that have been coming in while we've been talking. And I guess, Dara, I'll ask you to start with this first one, and then if Jim or Alex want to make any comments, we'll try to keep all the responses pretty brief if we can, so we can get through a few of these. But talk to us about failure, Dara. When has scale not worked? Or how many of your interviewees saw failure as an essential element in the learning process? And how can we talk about, you know, not expecting success or painting everything with a rosy picture, but really, you know, taking some risks and learning from failure?
Oh, absolutely. Failure is a really well-documented part of a scaling initiative, I think. And a lot of the folks that I spoke with said that while it's very important to, you know, scaling what works is about having a strong evidence base that is suggestive of positive outcomes and evidence of what works. However, scaling processes are, by definition, unpredictable. And therefore, it's really important to build in a great deal, and I think this is why we spend a lot of time talking about capital. It's important to build in a lot of flexibility for grantor as well as grantees involved in any growth process to be able to both absorb changes in work plan and growth along the way, but also to be able to have some resilience, because I think that is a standard part of the scaling process. There will be changes, successes, as well as failures. And having flexibility in terms of capital, reporting, and communication along the way is really essential.
Great. And Jim, maybe I'll pose this next question to you, and feel free to add any comment on that failure question as well. But we've gotten lots of questions around how local and regional funders play in this space. So what's the role of a regional funder if this California program takes off and Idaho and Kentucky and Massachusetts want to do it, or California groups want to export it there? What role do you play in that? And then how do folks learn about what's happening at the local level, and how do we connect some of these different local things together?
Well, Nancy, I realized I failed to highlight in my earlier comment was we do see everything we're doing is happening through partnerships with others. So while, you know, we're one of a series of actors in California working on children's health, and we are closely aligned with Kaiser Permanente in California and some other kind of major players in the health field. In terms of local funders, we are also engaging local funders in the different places and seeking synergy with them. So, for example, in Sacramento, there's a local foundation that's doing some really innovative work on juvenile justice, which is something we care about, and we're having a dialogue about how we lend support to what they're doing and further their research and effort. And in regards to the other states, I'm not quite sure I understood that part of the question.
Well, if Kentucky and Massachusetts and Idaho see what you guys are doing and say, hey, we'd love to do that there, what role, if any, does the California Endowment have? Or if some of those local programs that you're supporting in California want to expand beyond California, do you have a role to play in that?
I think we would be happy to be connected to others in other parts of the country that are pursuing similar goals and would want to be engaged. I mean, this is all a field, and I think one of the ways you achieve the momentum and the public will you need to both go to scale, and once you start scaling up to hold your ground, which I think is very difficult, is you cannot work in isolation, and you have to, you know, be as much as connected and spread the work that you're doing and what as much as possible. I think one of the ways you can guarantee that you won't ever, you know, you're going to have a real trouble getting to scale is if you work in isolation.
Great.
Just to reinforce that point that, some of the failures that can be avoided have to do with not collaborating and doing things in isolation. It's clear that scaling requires significant dollars and more than most foundations have individually, and we want to risk, and so collaborating on the funding side, and also though collaborating on the implementation as the rollouts go forward, and this is true nationally and locally.
Yeah, and I think it's easy for us to sit here, I think, and say collaboration is so important, it's the way to do this. The implementation of collaboration is sometimes challenging and time-consuming and costly, and I think we all agree there's a value in it, but I will recognize that sometimes that's easier said than done, so we want to be open and honest about that as well. So we're almost at the end of our time, and I do want to just highlight, first of all, thank again our panelists for some really great insight and for taking time to participate with us in this conversation. As we look at what's coming in the future that will enable folks to continue this conversation, we do have those remaining briefing papers. We will host webinars around those clusters or perhaps individual papers. We also have a series of skill-building workshops coming to a city near you on how to assess and support nonprofit financial health, understanding investing for growth, and then building the capacity for evaluation and learning. And you'll see the dates here again. These slides will all go out to people. So if there's a workshop coming to a neighborhood near you, we'd love to have you join us. We'll also be sending around an evaluation. Certainly want to remind people of the Growth Philanthropy Network conference, the Exchange Conference happening in June. Also, for those of you who are GEO members, the GEO Listserv is also a venue where we can continue these conversations, and I encourage you to post some of the questions you sent in to us today, which were great, on the Listserv, and let's see what kind of conversation we can keep going there. Lastly, lots of people have put in comments and questions around the life cycle and how do different funders engage small funders, big funders. We're looking at this life cycle of scale or growth and what are the rules for different kinds of funders and funding at each stage. And hopefully that's a product we can put out for conversation and continued input as we move forward. Again, if you have any other questions, please feel free to stay in touch with the Scaling What Works team. We want to hear from you. And thanks again to everyone for participating. All the great comments from the listeners and viewers of our webinar and to our panelists. Have a great day, everybody.